him shall have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Notice in verse 40, Jesus says, anyone. If we remember, anyone is also used earlier on in the chapter, where anyone, it could be any person, it could be any tribe, any nations, but Jesus will preserve his people. If we remember Romans 8:30, that he will carry them, keep them, and hold them. The true mark of a Christian is perseverance, that you will make it through. No. Life is not about being perfect. Christian life is not about being perfect. It's not about perfection. It's about direction. Notice the Christian is pursuing holiness and righteousness. He's pursuing Jesus. Notice Jesus will keep them, and he will bring them up and raise them up on the last day. If we remember in Isaiah, we can read where the prophet Isaiah says in chapter 40, I believe it's verse 23, that he gathers the lambs up into his arms and carries them. This is the story of the good shepherd Jesus preserves. Many people will say, well, Jesus failed me. I prayed to Jesus and I went through this calamity. I went through this storm and Jesus just failed me. Religion failed me. Christianity failed me. The Bible failed me. God failed me. No, in actuality, you got a hold of some very faulty doctrine. You've got a hold of something that wasn't the truth, that the truth was twisted or told in part. And if the truth is divided and separated, it's not really the truth. Maybe there's a kernel of truth. And think of this, congregation, that rat poison tastes yummy until you get to the middle of it. Some of the doctrine floating around out there is sugar-coated, almost like a bakery, a Christian bakery. It's sugar-coated, but the middle is horrible. It's twisted doctrine. Sometimes people go through bad things. Bad things happen to people. They lose loved ones. Sicknesses infest their body. They lose their jobs. They lose their home. They lose possessions. But Jesus tells them, I will preserve them. I will keep them. I will take care of them. Notice Boneyard. Notice, congregation, you go through hard times. Even David said, I'm going up on the rough side of the mountain. I'm going through the valley of the shadow of death. I'm going through the fire. I'm going through the storm. I'm going through something, Pastor Kevin. I'm making it through. I'm sick. I'm tired. I'm weary. I'm lonely. I'm angry. I'm bitter. We go through these things to be sculpted into the image of Christ. We can read what it says in Romans, that all things, divorce, losing a loved one, sicknesses, we losing our jobs, we go through all things comes and makes us work out for the good. We may have sicknesses that rack our bodies, and maybe you're watching right now from a hospital bed, or you have a ventilator, you can hear the beep, beep, beep over my preaching. Maybe you're sitting there and you're mourning the loss of a relationship or a friend, or you put your babies in the ground. But Jesus tells us that all things work towards good. No, we don't know at the time. We don't understand. We're going through the storm like the disciples did earlier in chapter 6. They're going through the storm and we don't see Jesus nowhere around. We see the waves crashing and the thunder rolling, and we hear the cries of an angry sea. But we need to hear the promises of a good shepherd. He said, I will not leave you, forsake you. We can read what it says in Joshua chapter 1, verse 5. He says, I am with you. I'm with you wherever you go. I won't forsake you and I won't fail you. You may look around and says, it looks like you're failing me, Jesus. Looks like you're letting me down, Jesus. The mortgage is due. The babies are sick. My wife is losing her mind. My spouse is going crazy. Jesus, you're failing me. But we can read here that Jesus preserves those that are his. He surrounds them. We can go through the storm and still have perfect peace. We can go through the issues and still give God praise. We can still be sick and worship him and glorify him. So we don't waste our sicknesses. We don't waste our unemployment. We don't waste our loneliness. We give God praise through all those afflictions. Prosperity dulls the heart. It makes us comfortable. It makes us forget about God. And we get our bills paid and we're looking good and we got it all together. We're looking really good and the house is clean and the car's running good. The job's paying. We're looking good and we forget about God. We forget all about God. We walk around like Nebuchadnezzar did in Daniel chapter 4. He says, look at all that I did. Look at what I did. Look, I did all this right. I hooked it up. It's because of my talent. It's because of how good looking I am. It's because of my last name. It's because I can sing good. It's because I'm smart. I'm intelligent. I'm holding it all together. It's all about me. But God reminds us. God sometimes will come in and kick the legs out from under us to drive us to our knees, to remind us, because we had the tendency for our heads to swell and our hearts to go numb, that we believe it's about ourselves. And that's what Jesus is getting ready to have a discourse with his disciples and the crowd, telling them it's about him. Congregation, wherever you're sitting right now, you're saying, I may be sitting in the hood and God's failed me. I may be sitting in the penthouse and God's failing me. No, he preserves those. God preserves his disciples. He preserves his Christians, his children. He takes care of them. He keeps them. You may say, God's forsaken me. No, he hasn't. He's bringing you through those things. He's bringing you through those things so you'll look to him, so you'll be pressed into the throne room and cry out to a holy and righteous God. Meaning, many times, the afflictions of the righteous, it does more for them than comfort and prosperity. Jesus is telling us here, in the last day he will rise them up. Maybe you're downtrodden now. Maybe you're going through the valley of the shadow of death. Maybe you're walking through death itself. But Jesus will lift you up and keep you and carry you. Notice what Jesus says in verse 41. It says the Jews grumbled. Notice they grumbled, just like we do. When we hear the preacher saying that Jesus will carry you, Jesus will not fail you, he'll be with you, he's the source, he's the soul food, he's the reason for it all, we grumble. We grumble because we say, well, what about us? What do I bring to the equation? Well, if you really want to know, congregation, what you bring to the equation is nothing more than your sin. You come to the cross with dirty rags, like it says in Isaiah 64:6. You come with an unrighteous, wicked heart, like it says in Jeremiah 17:9. You come with your meditations and thoughts nothing but wicked all day long, like it says in Genesis 5:6. That's what you bring to the equation. You bring nothing. You come to the cross. You need to come empty-handed, throw down those idols, and cling deep into that old rugged wood and hold on to Jesus as if it were a life preserver in the middle of the ocean. Cling, holding on tight, letting those things go, those things that will distract you, those toys, those idols, those things that you think are awesome achievements that will benefit you, clinging to cross. Like Paul said, I press forward, forgetting those things that are behind me. I press in. To press in, you gotta lean. You gotta lean. Press in like a sprinter at the finish line. He leans in, leaning to the cross, bearing your full weight. Jesus is strong enough to carry you. Notice in verse 41, the Jews grumbled. They grumbled about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They said, is this not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, the mother and father we know? Who does he now say, I have come down from heaven? They were so acquainted with Jesus. They knew all about Jesus. They knew he grew up on the corner with the boys. They knew all about Jesus. They knew his mom and daddy and them was. They knew all about Jesus. They knew where he went to school, who his friends were. They were very familiar with Jesus. So they couldn't hold to the claims of what he said. Congregation, what about you? When you go speaking about this Jesus, the Jesus who carries you when you can't walk, the Jesus who's your eyesight when you can't see, the Jesus who carries the brokenhearted, who binds up their iniquities and wounds and he heals them with the gospel. When you go preach to your family and your friends, they'll say, who are you? Ain't you old Buki and Tommy and them? Ain't you old JoJo? Ain't you Sister Snotgrass? Ain't you that guy that used to sell weed on the corner? Ain't you that self-righteous, prideful, religious man that went to my church and now you're talking about Jesus? Because they're all familiar about you already. Many of us will go back to our family and we'll be a disciple and we'll be an evangelist. We'll be a missionary and tell them about Jesus. But they're so familiar with us, they'll deny it. They'll say, no, man, I know all about you. I know all about you. But Jesus here, if we read in other Gospels, Gospel of Mark chapter 4, he says he was astonished in his hometown of Nazareth because they would not believe in what he was saying because they were so familiar with him. Jesus now, and before we go any further, many of us are very familiar with Jesus still. We grew up in the church, or our grandma used to take us every Sunday. We're familiar with Jesus. We know he was crucified on the cross. We know all the facts about Jesus, almost like he was a celebrity. Yeah. Many people know all about celebrities. They're on the cover of magazines. We know where they go to eat, what they wear. We know who they're married to and who they divorce. We know all about the celebrities. But the celebrities don't know us. If we read in Galatians, I believe it's Galatians chapter 2, that we are known by God. Does God know you? Yeah, you may be familiar with Jesus. Yeah, you may wear the t-shirt that says, Jesus is my homeboy. You may be familiar with Jesus. You may even be able to quote scripture. You may even know the Bible inside and out. You may even memorize the maps in the back and know the geographical location of Jerusalem. You may know all these things, but does God know you? You may know the facts. You may be familiar with Jesus, like this crowd was as Jesus is talking to them and say, yeah, I know all about Jesus. I'm going to go do my own thing. I know all about Jesus. I know Jesus, but he's not your Lord. You may even proclaim him be the Son of God, like even the demons do, and they shake and tremble, but he's not your Lord. Notice as the discourse continues, Jesus answering them in verse 43, Jesus said, do not grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father draws him, and I will raise him up in the last day. See, Jesus is getting ready to teach some good doctrine here. And he's saying that no one can come to the Father. No one. No one can come to the Father unless the Father draws him. Notice, how do you draw water out of a well? You don't say, oh, please come, get out of the well, jump in the bucket, come, and persuade it. You don't play music for 2 hours repeating the same tune over and over. You dip the bucket into the well and draw it out. Jesus is telling us here that God snatches those from hell and draws them to the cross. To better understand this, here's an illustration. Imagine my little boy. His name's Levi. And imagine Levi was sprinting towards a highway, busy highway. He was going back, and the highway was busy. And Levi is set in his heart to run into the highway, to run at a full sprint, go into the highway. And he's determined to run into the street. And who knows what will be the result of this. So I'll scream at the top of my lungs, yelling at Levi to stop. And maybe he's still set in his heart to run. So I'll snatch him by the collar and pull him back to safety. This is what this part of Scripture is telling us about, that God saves those. Now you might be saying, Kevin, no, wait a minute. That Jesus died for the whole world, but we know that we are dead in our sins, that our free will is tainted by sin. We can read that in Ephesians chapter 2, that our sin, we are dead in our sins. Our righteousness is filthy rags. We are dirty, wicked, and we do have free will. We're free to sin all we want. Maybe there's a part in your life where you say, well, Kevin, I understand, but I can choose Jesus. I can come to him, but I really want to explain to you that Lazarus couldn't choose to raise from the dead. That Lazarus had to hear the voice of God telling him to come forth. We are dead in our sins. We're dead, and Jesus raises us up for good works. We read Ephesians chapter 2 that we were created for good works, and once we do the good works, we give him glory. Continue along in verse 45. It is written in the prophets, and it will be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. God draws his people. He draws his people. Now in this group, these people, disciples, there's many of those who are following Jesus for the wrong reasons. There are false disciples. There's false Christians, false converts who are following Jesus. But once he starts teaching this, they start walking away because it's a hard saying. It's a hard teaching. Looking in verse 46, not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say unto you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. Now Jesus is speaking to the crowd who was gloating about Moses and how Moses supplied for the children of Israel, how he rained down manna from heaven, and Jesus corrects them later on in the chapter and tells them that it wasn't Moses who supplied the manna, it was actually God. Now Jesus tells them that they ate this bread that sustained their life, kept them alive, but Jesus is the heavenly bread that not only sustains them, but brings them into a new life, that regenerates them and gives them a new heart, that Jesus is the heavenly bread. Notice Jesus tells us in verse 50, this is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat it and will not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. And anyone who eats this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give him will be life. And the word is my flesh. Of the world is my flesh. Jesus is telling them that he's the living bread. Notice the manna had no life to it. It just came down and sustained. But the people who ate the manna died in the desert. But those who eat the living bread from heaven, which is Jesus, the claim of deity. Notice Jesus said, I am the living bread. He says, I am seven times, which reminds us what God said to Moses in Exodus. I am, I am. He repeats that I am self-sustaining. I am, I am. I'm all-powerful. I am. Jesus repeats and reflects the same thing in this teaching here, saying that the people think that Jesus needs them, but Jesus is teaching them and showing them that he is, I am, self-sustaining, all-powerful and sovereign. Jesus is the bread of heaven, and his body he gives as flesh for the Christian to eat. Now you're saying, Kevin, what? As we go into verse 52, the Jews are disrupted among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Notice Jesus is speaking spiritual now. Now, he made a transition from talking about theological issues of history and teaching about how Moses gave the children of Israel manna. Now he's saying what he'll give. Well, he'll provide spiritually for his disciples. And now the Jews and the disciples and the crowd who were following Jesus are now not catching what Jesus is teaching. They say, how would this man give us his flesh to eat? Verse 53. So Jesus says to them, truly, truly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the living Father, so whoever feeds on me, and who also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not as the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. Jesus said these things in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. Jesus was speaking spiritually about his disciples who will nourish upon the idea of the cross of Calvary, that it would nourish us and strengthen us. That just like bread and wine and food and meat gives our physical body strength, that the Christian meditates on what Jesus does. It gives us spiritual zeal and passion. It reminds us and it gives us strength, and it carries us through to do good works, remembering the sacrifice that Jesus, remembering that he is the source, like it says in John 15:5, I am the true branch. I am the true vine, and we are the branches. You can do nothing separated from me. Jesus tells us these things, reminding the people that it's about him. That what is what he's done, that's what we get sola de gloria. He alone gets the glory. Jesus alone, he is the one who provided for his people. Picking up in verse 60, and many of the disciples heard it, and they said, this is a hard saying. Who can listen to it? But Jesus, knowing himself that his disciples were grumbling about this, he said to them, do you take an offense at this? Verse 60, and then what if you were also to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? This, it is the Spirit who gives life. This flesh is of no avail, which is to say the flesh has no strength. It has no credit, no credentials, nothing of value in the flesh. The words that I have spoken to you are the Spirit of life. Verse 64, but there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who were his and who did not believe, and who would not, and who would betray him. And he said, this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it's granted by the Father. That God draws those people to the cross. That it's God who does a work in the heart of man, because man is depraved and left to his own devices, will wallow in his own sin. A man is dead in the graveyard of religion. Man is dead in the graveyard of rebellion. And without speaking to the dead men to rise up, they will stay in that state unless God raises them up to give them faith to believe in God. Let us continue, verse 66. After this, many disciples to turn back and walk with him no longer. So Jesus said to the 12, do you want to go away as well? And Simon Peter, notice what Simon says, and notice how Jesus corrects him and teaches him good, rich theology. Simon Peter answered him, Lord, where shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and come to know that you are the Holy One of God. They're saying, no, Jesus, we're not going anywhere. Yeah, it's good that Peter said you're the Holy One of God, and we've come to know this thing, and we come to believe, and we come to follow you. But Jesus, what he says in verse 70, lays the smackdown on Peter's elitism, saying that Peter had inside revelation better than those that left Jesus and walked away. The ones who didn't believe what Jesus was saying, that he is the true source and he's the one who gets all glory. Notice what Jesus says to Peter when he says the statement. Verse 70, Jesus answered in him, did I not choose you, the 12? And yet one of you is a devil. Jesus was telling Peter that, no, you're not staying with me because you have inside revelation. You're not staying with me because you have understanding far beyond the people that walked away. You're not staying with me. Didn't I choose you? Didn't I choose all 12 of you? Jesus is showing his sovereignty once again. He's saying that he keeps those that he chooses. That's why we hear the poignard, don't believe once saved, always saved. No, don't get me wrong. We don't believe once saved, always saved. We believe once saved, fully saved. You say, Kevin, what are you talking about? If you read Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, that Jesus saves to the uttermost. That Jesus saves absolutely. That Jesus is sovereign. He's Lord of all. Many of us have this notion. We have this idea that Jesus is an old poor farmer in the corner with his hat rolled up and saying, please, please accept me. Please let me live in your life. Please, please live for me. Please, please, please. And we beg people to come to the altar when in actuality Jesus is high and lifted up on his throne. And God draws his true believers to him. That God snatches those and saves them in spite of themselves, for himself, by himself. Jesus saves sinners. Jesus saves the wicked. He chooses the most unlikely evangelists. He chooses the craziest. He chooses the wrecked, the wretched. He chooses them and saves them. Now many were saved. That's not fair. God shows favoritism that he saves some and not others. But many of us think that God owes us salvation. The fact that you're watching this show and your conscience is not screaming, you should be very afraid. If we read in Romans chapter 1 and 2 that our conscience is seared, that God has turned us over to live however we want, you need to cry out to a living God. Cry out to a living God, save me, wash me, draw me near to the cross, draw me to Calvary where the Emmanuel's blood flowed and died for sinners like me. Oh, wretched sinner, if you're sitting there and you're not moved in conscience, if you're not crying out to God, be very afraid that God has turned you over to your own heart's lust. That God has allowed your conscience to be quiet. That God has allowed you to sin all you want because you don't want God. You rebel against God. You turn against God. You provoke God. So he turns you over to live however you want. But the true believers, the true Christians are hearing this and they cry sola de gloria. They know that they bring nothing to the equation but the grace that God flows on them. They bring only their sin to the cross. They don't have intellect. They don't have education. They don't have a pedigree of a bloodline. They come to the cross humble and broken. And they seek the gospel that Jesus saves sinners. So turning to Jesus, throw down your idols, trust Jesus, listen to your conscience, repent of your sins and trust in Jesus. Repent of your sins and trust in Jesus.